Oh my God, I'm very tired. I'm guessing most of you are as well. So I'll try and get through this pretty quickly. You'd have to question the logic of organizing a massive piss up the night before a day like today. Anyway, I'll be relying heavily on my notes because this was a creation that happened after leaving the pub last night and waking up with an unmerciful hangover this morning. But should be good. We'll be okay. Okay, well, yeah. So re-entering the Eurozone with old friends and new. What the lad said, it's to do with cooperating and international opportunities. And if you could bear in mind that Rubicon is an actual Irish company, so this is one of our international opportunities in the UK. So just to bear that in mind. Rubicon started out life as an Irish subsidiary of a Scottish company. It was, there we go. One second now. It was set up to kind of exploit opportunities in the Celtic Tiger economy around 2000, all around the road schemes that Ronan was talking about earlier. The company grew and eventually gained its independence, but the DNA of the business is hardwired for cooperation with like-minded people and an ambition to explore new markets. So what I'll be talking about today is I'll be running through the journey of Rubicon, really developing trading companies in Ireland, UK, and more recently in Germany, and looking at how cooperation with like-minded partners has developed us to be in the privileged position of undertaking some of the largest and most complex projects available to archaeologists in recent years. Right. This slide kind of provides an overview of quite a complex corporate structure, which we seem to have got ourselves into. We have a group structure, basically, with three trading companies. So there is in Ireland, we have Rubicon Heritage Services. In the UK, we have Red River Archaeology. And then in Germany, we have Rubicon Archaeology GmbH. I'm just about really able to pronounce it. Within our own kind of group setup, we have a kind of an internal international market, which is proving incredibly useful as things develop. However, today I'm going to be talking mostly about our joint venture vehicles, and how we're engaging in our experience of working in that shared environment. So we have Infra JV UK, which is our original JV, which takes on large UK infrastructure projects. And then we have Infra Europe, which is our recently expanded joint venture, which engages in large infrastructure projects outside of the UK. And Mark Collard and me were talking about this yesterday. He referred to it as Lego. And that's more or less what it is. It basically was you have a problem and your solution is to add blocks to infra. So it's unincorporated. We haven't set up a limited entity, corporate entity. So it's just kind of working under a joint venture agreement, which works really well. And then depending on what you're wanting to go out and do, you can change the blocks. Right. So I'll start by running through our initial experience of joint venture working within the Infra family, through Infra JV in the UK. Through this, I'll run through some of our experience of collaborative working on HS2, some of the challenges we encountered, and lessons we learned. So back in 2017, Rubicon and Network, but basically it was Mark Collard and David Bonner, were kind of sitting around and bumped into each other a lot. The two medium-sized companies began exploring opportunities on HS2. Neither was big enough to take on the work independently, so we formed Infra Joint Venture. We had very complementary business models and a shared culture, and it became obvious to us that together we were bigger than the sum of the two businesses. Each company had over 20 years' experience in providing archaeological services, ahead of linear infrastructure in particular, We had a combined workforce of over 150 archaeologists and a track record which covered 8,000 kilometres of pipelines, cable routes and roads. A wise man once said that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, a statement which has never been truer than in the context of a well-functioning joint venture. In fact, I'd say that the litmus test of a successful joint venture is that there is always added value when you work together, for the members of the joint venture and for the client. So in 2018, Infra tendered successfully for the central section of the HS2 enabling works contract. This involved a stretch covering approximately 100 kilometres from the outskirts of London to south of Birmingham. We were one of a number of suppliers, many of you in this room, engaged to deliver archaeological works on this section with everyone working to the same requirements. Our client was Fusion JV, who was retained by HS2 Limited. So what do we do? Between 2018 and 2022, we focused on a 40-kilometre stretch of the route from Great Missenden to Bicester, basically running through Buckinghamshire and Oxfordshire. We undertook 35 separate investigations, which covered 1,100 evaluation trenches, 240,000 square metres of mitigation, and 2,500 test pits. The fieldwork was delivered by a team that averaged at about 80 archaeologists. The results of the work involved the production of 156 post-excavation reports. In addition, we were responsible for supplying all plant, welfare, construction of compounds and access. All access had to be built over the surface and involved laying metal plates over kilometres of routes into the working areas. This was a huge logistical undertaking and placed us in a similar situation as a principal contractor. It involved a huge amount of new skills and continuous training for the staff. So all the work was undertaken in accordance with a large number of requirements, which included technical standards, archaeological research standards, and of course, safety, health, environment, and quality requirements. This is all under constant scrutiny in order to maintain compliance both for us and for our clients. Quality was the key, and huge demands were placed on the team and the off-site management. It was a fantastic, if sometimes painful, learning process. In addition to keeping our clients happy, we also had to satisfy our stakeholders, such as Historic England and the various county archaeologists. So challenges, there were a few. Delivering work on this scale presents constant and changing challenges. The delivery programme had to be tight because we had non-archaeological works hot on our heels. We had to record the archaeology before anything else could happen. This led us to the mantra, right first time. We invested huge resources in planning every step so that we got it right first time, another demand on off-site management and constant review of our quality management systems. Resourcing was critical. We simply could not deliver the work without a motivated team of highly experienced archaeologists. This was achieved by giving the archaeologists a good deal, including wage increases, performance bonuses, and mental health support at some quite stressful times. We also ensured people had high-quality living accommodation and the welfare facilities on site were excellent. However, the most important means of making sure that our workforce was happy was ensuring that we listened to their concerns. The logistics were also challenging, but very rewarding, and we became experts at building access and compounds and ensuring that all deliveries and attendances were in the right place at the right time in order to keep the archaeologists fully supported. On top of this, we had an extraordinary level of documentation of performance reporting, which needed to be updated daily in order to keep everything compliant. So, our key learnings. A close and honest relationship with the client is fundamental to delivering projects on this scale. Peaks and troughs don't work for either the client or the contractor. Our client learned really quickly that the only way to ensure sufficient capacity was to maintain a constant workflow. We recognised that it was essential to have a clear division between archaeological management and commercial management. The commercial team needs to be trained in the application of the relevant form of contract and be supported by experts. The archaeological team needs to focus on the archaeology and not be distracted by the cut and thrust of the commercial process. So, we've gained quite a lot from the experience. We've developed tried and tested systems throughout all areas of our joint venture. We're now a mature joint venture with a secure delivery process and certified quality management system. Our logistical capabilities have grown tenfold because they had to. We have in-house training programs because training is essential in order to react to what a mega project can throw at you. So, life after HS2. As Linfra, we really enjoyed the process of working in a joint venture and also the scale of works required by HS2. Ourselves and Network both agreed that this was something that we felt was worth maintaining and developing. We tendered for National Highways as Infra and were successfully added to the National Highways Archaeology Framework. Also at this time, we started to hear about a mega project in Germany called Südlink, which we felt might be suited to collaborative working. As an Irish company, Rubicon is a client of Enterprise Ireland, which is the Irish government's enterprise development agency. Through Enterprise Ireland, we engaged in the Enter the Eurozone program, with two directors from Rubicon taking part in an intensive 5-month program supported by a mentor with experience of entering the European market. This identified 5 potential countries in Europe which were believed to be suitable markets for us. Through engagement with the program and peer learning, we narrowed this down to an optimum opportunity for Rubicon, which was determined to be Germany. The final part of the program was to develop a market entry plan for Germany. Following on from the Enter the Eurozone program, we successfully applied for a market discovery grant, again from Enterprise Ireland. This provided us with support to explore opportunities in Germany, including market intelligence, potential local delivery partners, and an understanding of the required corporate structure to keep us compliant. The result was Infra Europe, a beefed up version of Infra, but with 3 additional German companies. ADW, based in Baden-Württemberg, SPAU, based in Hessen, and SWA, or Südwest Archaeology, who are based in Baden-Württemberg. Rubicon and Network both set up subsidiaries, and they're both based in Bayern or Bavaria. We identified potential German partners over a 6-month period, engaged with them in teams. We immediately clicked with company owners from ADW, SPAU, and SWA. ADW and SPAU had previously worked together, so there was the beginnings of a JV on the German side as well, and ADW and SPAU are also heavily involved in SIFA Deutschland. So again, we had some more common ground there. Right, on St. Patrick's Day, 2023, we officially launched Infra Europe JV in Frankfurt through the signing of a joint venture agreement in the presence of Anne-Marie Flynn, the Consul General of Ireland in Frankfurt, Dr. Nicholas O'Brien, the Irish Ambassador to Germany, Pascal Donoghue, an Irish Cabinet Minister, and Uwe Becker, the State Secretary for Europe in the Hessen government. And only the Irish do this. Like, if you're a company trying to export your services, I couldn't imagine the UK government doing this. They not only kind of put all the bigwigs out to help us launch our enterprise, but they put on free Guinness, and everybody was absolutely hammered. It was fantastic. The glasses were a bit small, but anyway, it was okay. So no, but it was a fantastic night. The German partners couldn't believe that we could mix with our politicians in that way, because they're so separated for them. Whereas like in Ireland, like you meet them down the local shop and things like that. But yeah, it was just an absolutely fantastic night and a great way to kick this thing off. It built bridges like you wouldn't believe. So, our target project was Südlink, the largest underground electricity transmission cable in the world, running for 700 kilometers through Germany and with a 45-meter wide easement. Absolutely massive. This will provide connectivity between the wind energy in the north of the country and the solar energy in the south, and will also connect Germany to neighbors in Scandinavia and open up access to huge hydro energy potential there. So infra tendered for the southern section, which is the bit that's lit up on this map. And it's basically 462 kilometers from Niedersachsen to Baden-Württemberg. We were successful in all six lots which we tendered for. We signed contracts in August, and we were on the ground digging holes in September. Right, how's it going? It's going good, but very challenging, and we are learning a lot. We're working everywhere except Niedersachsen at the moment, and that is coming to come. So we are fine-tuning our process for initiating projects in different states, deploying and equipping our teams, and ensuring that the required reporting for both our clients and the state authorities is provided and quality assured in German. There's a long list of challenges. I'm not going to joke about this, but it's a tough market to crack. Language was always going to be a challenge, obviously. The English is the lingua franca for daily project management, but German is the language for reporting and dealing with the various heritage authorities. All of the plant hire companies, employees, all the guys driving the machines speak only Polish. As we are located at the heart of Europe, our team is drawn from numerous countries, so we have developed a risk assessment for language for every stage of work in order to mitigate any issues that might result from using a multilingual workforce. And you'll immediately start thinking of health and safety, but we're thinking of quality of archaeology as well. Germany is an incredibly bureaucratic country, and compliance issues are everywhere and in many cases well hidden. So there's lots of little surprises that we still keep getting on a kind of a monthly basis. Some examples, like just as we were signing contracts, legislation was introduced in Germany in August 2023, which prevents mechanical excavation on soils which have reached a certain water saturation point. All of the sites are visited regularly. All of our sites are visited nearly daily by the UBB team, which is the soil moisture inspection team. Work can be stopped by the UBB team with no notice. And this has caused massive impacts on our program. We've also been stopped by the local fauna. So including wild boar roaming around the place and the Northern European field hamster. Federalism is a very real challenge when working in multiple states in Germany. Each state does archaeology radically different. Teams for one state are not always acceptable in the neighboring state. So for instance, we can have a team working in northern Baden-Württemberg. And if we've been told by the client to move them 10 miles north, and we move 10 miles north, we move into Bavaria, and we have to change the team leaders because they don't have the required qualifications to work in Bavaria. There's distinct cultural differences also that we've needed to be aware of. Health and safety, for instance, generally can be a bit fast and loose in the construction and archaeology industries in Germany. I'm delighted to say that on Südling, the Südling project, it is a definite requirement. It was a bit of a struggle, but we've instilled a safety culture into all our teams, and they no longer question the need for full PPE, for instance. Generally, doing business and work ethic also have subtle differences. I was initially in shock when everyone turned their computers and phones off at 4:30, and it is considered rude to contact people outside of work hours unless you're going for a beer. So the plan is you just ring people up and ask them to go for a beer, and then when they come to the pub, you talk archaeology. And they seem happy with that. So possibly the most challenging aspect of the job is the program. We're currently working in the enabling stages prior to the client getting planning permission. We're therefore working on smaller scale interventions on multiple fronts over a large geographical area. This makes programming extremely challenging. As contractors, we need to find the balance between running the project lean and having capacity to upscale as required by the client. And with regard to the logistics, working over a 462 kilometer route with short term investigations on multiple work fronts is very challenging. Teams are constantly moving. Clients' requirements change constantly due to access arrangements and project priorities. Yeah, so some of the learnings. Yeah, don't be that guy. We need to accept that we are working in a foreign country with established process. There is no doubt that we do archaeology differently than our German colleagues, but we are working in their environment, so need to adjust our systems to deliver archaeology to the requirements of each German state we work in. There's no harm in suggesting improved ways to deliver the results, but change will come slowly and only with the cooperation of the German archaeology community. The other three items listed here are kind of building on the experience in HS2. The one team culture, if you stick two archaeologists in a trench on a rainy day, the first thing that, well, they just talk about wages and conditions all day. So they'll know exactly what the other person's getting. So if we have five companies with different groups of employees all integrating into different teams, they all need to get the same deal. So everybody gets the same salary, conditions, training, anything else. It all has to be exactly the same. Everboarding. This is a new concept to me. Kind of onboarding is a snapshot of how things are when you on the day a new hire starts. Everboarding is a new concept in our business which provides constant updates on changes within Rubicon, the joint venture, and the project. Communications is another massive thing for us. Working in multiple languages in five states with five companies requires proactive and constant communication. And that extends into a very demanding client who also needs to be informed of everything that's happening. Right, one of the big challenges coming up in the next 6 months will see us moving from the enabling phase to construction and a significant increase in numbers of archaeologists on the ground. We're now recruiting in multiple countries. Our anticipation is that by this time next year, we'll have between 400 and 600 archaeologists working on Suedlink. So, and that is the situation that's going to develop over the next few months, and we'll get more information. But with the future, like we are looking at other similar opportunities elsewhere as infra. I suppose with us, it's not, we don't have any kind of massive strategy for kind of going after international markets. We just really want to be doing big projects. They're great fun. They're really good in archaeology. And that's really the space we're in. So we're not market driven, we're opportunity driven. So we're looking for places that have a project with a big demand for archaeologists, probably a small indigenous archaeological community. And that's kind of the Goldilocks zone for us. That's what we're after. It's great to have the support of the Irish government and Enterprise Ireland. They will help me go into any market I want in the world, like, and they're tooled up for it, which is great. I think that's just about. That's me. Thank you.